Hello. Is the microphone on? Okay. Hello. Good afternoon, and welcome to the Urban Institute and our discussion today on poverty in place, exploring the legacy of persistent poverty in America. I'm Greg Acs. I'm Vice President for Income and Benefits Policy here at the Urban Institute. And before we begin, I'd like to cover some quick housekeeping items. We are recording this event, and the recording will be posted online afterward. This is a hybrid event with attendees in person and online. For those of you inside the room, you can scan the QR code you see on the tables to access the event dashboard that includes speaker biographies and a link to our question and answer box for later in our conversation. Please be sure to check off that you're already registered. And third, I would like to invite you all to engage with us on social media by using the hashtag #LiveAtUrban. So, over five decades ago, Urban was founded to study the war on poverty, and this war seems to be endless. Today, our conversation about poverty has broadened. We understand that poverty is about more than just a lack of money. It's about a lack of power and control over your life. It's about a lack of dignity, about living in a society and a community that undervalues you and devalues you. For their new book, The Injustice of Place, Uncovering the Legacy of Poverty in America, Kathy Edin, Luke Shaefer, and Tim Nelson and their research teams embedded in four communities in major regions of deep disadvantage, interviewing low-income residents as well as community leaders, poring over centuries of local history and attending local events. Their analysis traces the legacies of deepest poverty in America and the mechanisms through which it persists, including inequalities shaping people's health, livelihoods, and upward social mobility. I'm happy to welcome Luke Shaefer, one of the authors, to discuss his work and insights. Dr. Shaefer's biography is available online, but by way of introduction, Luke is the Herman and Amalie Cohn Professor of Social Justice and Social Policy and Professor of Public Policy at the Gerald R. Ford School of Public Policy at the University of Michigan. At UM, he is also the inaugural director of Poverty Solutions, an interdisciplinary initiative that partners with communities and policymakers to find new ways to prevent and alleviate poverty. He is one of the nation's leading scholars of poverty and social welfare policy. His book with Kathryn Edin, $2 a Day, Living on Almost Nothing in America, was named one of the 100 notable books of 2015 by the New York Times Book Review and won the Hillman Prize for Book Journalism. Luke, welcome to Urban.
That was a nice move to let me get up first.
We try. All right. So, Luke, in your last collaboration with Dr. Edin, $2 a Day, you focused on individuals and their families and their struggles. And here you've shifted your focus to communities. How did your focus and interest evolve in this direction?
Yeah, so in that first book, we were really trying to understand what was going on with our poorest families, families living on virtually no cash income at all. But through that, we did have field sites in Appalachia and in the Mississippi Delta, and that was our first taste that things really differed across the country, depending on where you were. In Chicago, families were extremely poor, but there were some systems that could help them, shelter systems, healthcare systems, public transportation, and we could see that there wasn't that kind of infrastructure in some of the other communities we were in. And then all of this evidence started to, I think, become clear, in part by the work of the Urban Institute on mobility metrics, this ongoing program that's helping communities understand what's going on, where they are. We could see that poverty and opportunity and well-being are vastly stratified across place in this country. So life expectancies that are sometimes a decade different poverty rates, obviously, that are very different. And then with Raj and Nathan's work on mobility metrics, we could see the chances that a low-income kiddo would rise up to the middle class is alive and well in some communities. And in other communities, kids are likely to stay poor. So the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation reached out to us and they said, hey, do you want to do a project on the very poorest communities to follow up on your first book? And we said, yes, that's exactly what we want to do. And so we were really just lucky, I think, and blessed to partner with them and embark on this project.
So a lot of, you know, following on the work of Raj Chetty and his colleagues that show that place really does matter. The cottage industry has sort of evolved trying to figure out, you know, what are the pro-mobility aspects of place? And here, with your help, we've developed mobility metrics for all 3,000 plus counties in most major cities. But you've inverted that in this book. You flipped it. Instead of looking at what helps promote mobility, you're looking at what are the factors that entrench poverty. Can you tell us about the index you developed to identify these low mobility entrenched poverty places?
Yeah, so we wanted to have more of a multidimensional sort of approach to identifying disadvantage, and part that came out of the $2 a day project and not wanting to put all our eggs in one basket in terms of income measurement. We're aware of the pros and cons of that, but just as you said, I think this developing understanding that when people think about poverty, they're thinking about a lot more than that. So we drew down that data from Chetty and Hindren's mobility metrics. We drew down health information from the CDC through the county health rankings, and then kept our poverty rates still as a central piece of that, and put all of those into a principal component analysis, not wanting to sort of having any sense of how we should be weighting one or the other, trying to get a little help from PCA. And from that, we were able to build this ranking of all counties and cities across a continuum of disadvantage weighted with all of these factors. And the first thing that really struck out to us was when we're looking at the most disadvantaged places in the United States. So these are all counties in the 500 largest cities. That gets you down to cities of about 50,000. We were struck by how so many of these places that face the deepest disadvantage were rural communities. That in the first 100 most disadvantaged places, according to this index, we only had like 9 cities that appeared in that group. And yeah, we had some inkling of this from $2 a day, but it was kind of a wake-up call when you think about how much of our research, especially our qualitative research, is based in places like Chicago, that weren't even among the 600 most disadvantaged places. So that was, I think, the first wake-up call, and then all this data started to come out from there. I think a lot of people think of rural spaces as being predominantly white. And of course, when you look at the data, and especially these very disadvantaged communities, you see that many of them are communities predominantly of Black Americans, of Latinx Americans, of Native nations when you go out west. And I think some people think of these places as being uniformly poor. And in fact, by our standard metrics of inequality, they're very unequal. In fact, unequal, rivaling some of our most unequal places. So it was clear that we didn't understand a lot and actually brought a lot of assumptions that were just plain wrong to the table. And Kathy and I have been a big believer in what we call iterative mixed methods. So we wanted to combine the use of big data that could tell us things and allow us to generalize. But it doesn't tell you why a place does remain poor over a long period of time. It doesn't tell you really of the mechanisms of that persistence. And so we wanted to pair that with qualitative work. And as you mentioned, we embedded researchers and in Eastern Kentucky, in South Carolina, in the Tobacco Belt, in the Mississippi Delta, and then down in South Texas, our biggest sort of regions, our clusters of deep disadvantage. Mm-hmm. We interviewed low-income residents and community leaders. We engaged in community activities. And as themes emerged, we would always be coming back to the quantitative data. And our goal was to really posit some of the mechanisms by which we think this persistent disadvantage has has occurred over generations. Because early on, when we compared our map of disadvantage to historical maps, we could see this incredible connection, this incredible similarity between, say, a map of enslavement from 1860 mm-hmm. and our map of deep disadvantage today.
So when talking about the communities on the Mexico-Texas border, yeah. in the Cotton Belt, in Appalachia, you refer to them as internal colonies. Can you elaborate on that analogy?
Each one of these regions has uniqueness and like parts of their story that you don't get anywhere else. But as we started to get to know them and we started to compare notes, we had our research teams in each place doing these interviews. When COVID hit, we really delved deep into the histories. And you started to see some similarities emerge. So it turns out South Texas, the community we were in, Crystal City, prides itself in being the spinach capital of the world. And in fact, there are life-size statues of Popeye in a number of locations in Crystal City. And one can, if one chose, get a selfie with Popeye, which we all did. That is because at the turn of the 20th century, as they figured out irrigation from underground springs, South Texas became like the agriculture epicenter of the country. And all of our tabletop vegetables were predominantly coming from there. In Greenwood, Mississippi, that prided itself in being the cotton capital of the world. And one of the biggest annual events is the Cotton Bowl, and they crowned the cotton princess. So there was this sort of revolving around a single crop. And then in South Carolina, tobacco, right? The community we were in is actually where they discovered how to cure bright leaf tobacco that made cigarettes possible and revolutionized smoking for everyone. And then, of course, up in Appalachia, we had coal. But before we had coal, we had timber. And before we had timber, there was salt. So these were all places that revolved around a single industry, right? A single industry came to dominate the economy so much. A single industry controlled by a small number of people that the people who controlled that industry and controlled the economic part of life, but also the social fabric of life, use powers across all of those dimensions to continue to maintain that order. Because all of these industries required a large supply of cheap labor. And so you had a pattern that really doesn't exist across the United States as a whole of a community that was controlled by a small number of people that revolved around a single extractive industry. An industry, by the way, that wasn't just important to that community or the region, but important to the nation. And in the case of cotton and tobacco, really like central to the development of the industrialized Western world, where sort of the elite used every tool at their disposal to maintain a cheap labor force. And interestingly, in some cases, it's actually the same families. So what we found in South Texas was many of the farms that came to spring up after the 20th century were actually owned by people who had owned plantations in Mississippi and across the Cotton Belt, who, as it became harder to, because cotton is extractive of the soil, as it became harder to yield profits from cotton, actually moved down to Texas. And there are these stories from that period of plantations that are shuttered with signs that say, gone to Texas. So it's, in some cases, it's the exact same families. So you think of these regions as places that where great wealth was extracted on the backs of low-wage laborers to benefit an entire country and a set of people who had sub-citizenship for a long period of time, and the repercussions of that continue to ripple.
So continuing on with the single industry challenge, that also subjected these communities to extreme volatility and disruption. Can you talk about
that? That's right. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so beyond sort of a set of social relations that had toxicity that we think we still see play out today through coal mining, through slavery that then evolved into Jim Crow and tenant farming, through the migratory labor patterns in the deep South Texas, where it was sort of designed so that labor was only needed for a part of the year and set up this cycle of coming through the entire United States, through Michigan for cherries, that's where my home state comes in, and then back down to South Texas. You have these long-term social relations, but as you mentioned, when you put all your eggs into one basket, it also creates these boom and bust cycles. So you can see this over the course of history that when times are good with cotton, things are wonderful, at least for the small number of people who own all the resources. And then when prices plummet, or there's changes in technology or whatever it is, more global competition, then things get really bad really quickly. And it leaves communities very vulnerable to that. So two of our cities that do make it into the 100 most disadvantaged places are from my home state, the city of Flint and the city of Detroit. And they have some of the same similarities, right? You can actually see how a lot of these elements come through, not in as extractive an industry, but in putting all of their eggs in one basket of cars and then seeing the impacts of that over the course of the life cycle of, you know, the economic life cycle.
All right. So moving away from economics a bit,
yeah.
You talk about the importance of social cohesion and social capital, particularly as it relates to drug addiction and deaths of despair. What did you observe inhibiting or eroding social cohesion in the communities you visit, and where did you see successful efforts to build it?
So as we started to talk to families, especially in Appalachia, we were in Clay County in Kentucky, eastern Kentucky. The county seat is Manchester. And we started to talk to family after family. And of course, the opioid crisis is still alive and well there. It really is across the entire nation. We've have as many people dying of opioid overdoses now as we ever have in this country. And it's sort of transitioned some from prescriptions to illegal drugs. But the crisis is real. And as we talk to families, starting from this place of qualitative inquiry, wanting to really take seriously the sense that sometimes we don't know what we don't know, we would ask families, you know, what are the things that you would want to see to really try to put a dent in this? And we heard over and over again this line that kids get into drugs because there's nothing else to do. And quite frankly, the first time that I heard it, I didn't take it seriously. I thought this is not a sophisticated understanding of this incredible, you know, American crisis that we have. But when you hear it over and over again, if you take this iterative mixed methods type of approach seriously, you have to take it seriously. And we started to look at all of the evidence around this question. You know, is part of the reasons why communities experience levels of drug addiction because there's nothing else to do. So that's related to social capital, but it's really more about the places, the spaces where people can build that social capital. So we sort of think of it as all of us might be familiar about how more Americans are bowling alone, but maybe our contribution is that there's no bowling alley at all anymore. So we really actually just started to look right there and say, let's look at the best evidence that we have. This is not a case that I'm ready to bet my firstborn child on. But I think circumstantially, there's all this incredible evidence that when social infrastructure goes away, these spaces for people to make connection across differences, to have cheap fun. So these are bowling alleys. There are maybe local movie theaters. Arcades actually look to be a place where people can build connections. And you think about sometimes what they've been replaced with, right? The arcade is replaced with gaming systems in your house, far more isolating. So as these types of things, as barbershops leave communities, we can see in the best evidence that we have across the United States that opioid deaths rise. Similarly, as civic-minded organizations decline, you see opioid use rise and opioid deaths rise. And there's some really interesting evidence from the natural sciences. So I'm going to compare humans to rats, and everybody has to, I apologize for that, although we've all probably done that at some point, right? But it turns out if a poor little rat is in a lab in a cage and they get access to drugs and they're on their own, they will use the drugs most often. They will probably get addicted and they will often die. But if the little rat has other little rat friends and they have interesting things to do in the cage, they will only use the drugs recreationally. Very few will become addicted, and not a single one will die. So you think of it, like there's all this evidence that social connection, right? Having a great conversation with somebody, making this connection across difference, it triggers things in our brains, and drugs sort of mimics that. Another really interesting piece of evidence has to do with Vietnam. So Angus Deaton shared this with me. It turned out American soldiers in Vietnam used drugs in like mass quantities. And the two reasons that research suggests that was the case was one, the drugs were cheap, but two, they had nothing to do as they were waiting for whatever deployment or assignment or whatever going on. When they returned to the United States, Richard Nixon really didn't like this, right? So he sponsored a study. When Americans returned to well-structured lives in the United States, to different social networks, but also patterns for the day and places to go, they quit drug use at like shocking rates that I think most of our models of addiction would not support. So we think that there is a lot of evidence to suggest creating these like public spaces where people can have cheap fun, can build connection across differences, can help people have those connections, maybe avoid looking for those types of feelings in other ways, including drugs. And I think the new evidence suggests, bridging social capital across differences really can have a big impact on economic mobility.
Right. So in your new work with Poverty Solutions in Michigan, you're opening up bowling alleys.
Splash pads and bowling alleys.
Awesome.
Yeah. It was like one of the interesting things when we went back to Robert Wood Johnson. We said, hey, if you want to help communities, maybe you should be investing more in libraries, or maybe you should be investing more in arcades. And, I think one benefit of it would be really well received as well.
Mm-hmm. All right. So almost every conversation about economic mobility talks about education. And in your book, your discussions about education center on segregation and the resegregation of schools. Can you talk about how that has affected mobility in these places of entrenched poverty?
Yeah, I think all of us are aware at a conceptual level of the segregation of schools in the United States. This is one of the sort of thorniest challenges that we have. And we hope that our book really makes a contribution in understanding like the nuts and bolts of how that has persisted over time. One of my favorite passages of the books is about the rise of segregationist academies. So after Brown v. Board, for many years, states figure out ways to circumvent that. But in the 1960s, the Supreme Court basically said, you've got to do it, right? You've got to desegregate. And that created this huge transfer, basically, of white kids from public schools into private schools, segregationist academies. So over the 1960s, basically, and into the early 1970s, as there's just no more way to escape Brown, these private schools open up all across the South. You see a huge infusion of kids, and you see an extraction of resources from the public schools into these private schools. So sometimes just wholesale transfer of books, of resources, private schools that pop up sometimes with almost entirely the same name, the same school colors, maybe the school chants, right, and traditions have just been modified enough. And it creates this massive segregation of schools across the South. The Citizens Council, also known as the White Citizens Council, has step-by-step instructions in one of their magazines that was released in the 1960s about exactly how do you start a segregationist academy. And we really think that if you follow this story out, it is actually one of those great examples of where segregation hurts everyone. It hurts white kids as well as black kids in the South. You see that none of the schools end up being as good as they could have been together, because the teachers, right, that are teaching in these segregationist academies, and many of them where fewer resources are able to be to brought in, can be really, really low quality instruction. And that just sort of persists over time. And I then in South Texas, you have just lots of examples over the course of time where the schools, they figure out ways to maybe ostensibly integrate the schools between Anglo and predominantly Mexican-American kids, but keep all of the positions of power, right, or the positions of prestige for Anglo kids over the course of the years of high school. And one of my favorite stories in the book, because in each one of these communities, at some point, those who are don't have the resources in these communities rise up, right? There's always these stories of protest. A cheerleader revolt actually happens in South Texas in Crystal City, where they say, you know what, we're not going to put up with there only being one Mexican-American girl on the cheerleading squad and three Anglo girls, because we make up 85% of the school, and it leads to this 1,700-kid walkout of the public schools and a total standoff that goes on well over a month, and only with federal intervention does the school board acquiesce. And it becomes much more about, you know, about much more than the cheerleading squad. It becomes about the teaching of Mexican-American history in the schools, of changing who's professors and I'm sorry, who are teachers and who are the school counselors. And, you know, I think it's really a very fascinating moment in American history.
All right. So I want to turn now to violence. And you've documented high levels of interpersonal and institutional violence in the communities you studied. So to what extent does violence inhibit mobility, and to what extent is violence a response to inhibited mobility?
This was another one of those places where I went in thinking of violence as predominantly an urban issue. I think we talk about it that way, we think about it that way. Many of the people who are studying it are in urban communities. And again, we have such incredible heterogeneity among rural communities, where you have some rural communities, actually at the very other end of our index are also rural communities of upper Minnesota and actually North Dakota, which at some point we could talk about why we see such low poverty and low inequality and no violence. But especially our field sites in Mississippi and Appalachia and in South Carolina have extremely high levels of violence. And in fact, they're quite comparable to, you know, on a per person basis to places like Chicago that we spend an awful lot of time talking about. I think one of the things that I really took away from this book is the importance of history. So I think us as social scientists, we're aware of history. We've often studied history and understand that a lot of our challenges are sort of steeped in history. But then I think we usually move along with our analysis in an ahistorical way, as if all of our problems really just appeared out of thin air. And I think if you're thinking about violence in that way, it's easy to get into a place of blaming the victim. It's usually, in each one of these places, it's members of the lower income part of the community in violence with each other. But this is really just another instance of a long history of violence. And so many of these places that we were in also are at the epicenter of state-sponsored violence, which was used by elites in places to reinforce that social order that I was telling you about. So we can think about lynchings that didn't just serve the purpose of taking out one person, of a violent act against one person, but spreading a message across entire communities about you know, do not step out of line of this social order that benefits a few and doesn't the many. So, and another part of that was that any sort of act of uprising, right? We talked about how in each place at some point, the folks who are in the have-not camp sort of rise up. Any act like that could be sort of disproportionately punished with the economic goal of reinforcing the order. But any act of violence within the low-income community would be all but ignored. And so you can go back a century and see this exact cycle of low-income communities basically almost sort of turning a blind eye to violence in low-income communities. And so what I hope that we do is try to make this connection between economic opportunity and violence. So for decades, right, violence was used to reinforce a certain social order and almost guard against the economic mobility of a set of people. And we have very well documented in the literature that violence can inhibit economic mobility, right? Kiddos that grow up in communities that have, experience violence, they witness violence, maybe some of their family members are directly impacted, maybe they're directly impacted. This has a huge impact on their trajectory throughout their life. But we also think there's the other part of this cycle, that people who are in communities where their own economic mobility is inhibited by state-sponsored violence, by this sort of rigid social order, and by basically our structural reordering today, that inhibiting also, we think, can increase the likelihood of violence. So we have a paper that we've been working on that uses the Chetty and Hindren mobility metrics from the 1980s mm-hmm. to predict violence in communities in the 2000s. So right as that cohort was reaching sort of the prime years of violence. And what we found is like the level of economic mobility, right? This is the chance that if you grow up poor, you can rise to the middle class. That metric is more predictive of levels of violence in a community than the poverty rate, the level of inequality, the number of law enforcement officers, the unemployment rate, any of the standard metrics that we use to sort of predict violence today pale in comparison to the predictive power of the level of mobility. So this connection between hope and violence, we think, is incredibly clear.
I look forward to seeing that paper. So one last question before we broaden our discussion. Of all the places you visited, of all the people that you talked to, what is the one memory that stays with you?
Well, I think I'll point to two parts of it. In spending time in South Texas, that's what I was least familiar with. And I was struck by the housing stock in South Texas, which was some of the worst that I had ever seen. We were in some colonias, which are, you know, not sort of formal communities, but they're neighborhoods or communities. And just seeing those, the quality of the housing stock. And we actually came upon this sort of memorial in Crystal City of a World War II internment camp. So it turns out Crystal City was the site of the only internment camp, both for Japanese, but also German and Italian Americans, that was specifically designed for families. And it turned out the United States owned this big plot of land in South Texas because of a New Deal program that would buy up land from farmers as we went into the, you know, as we were in the Great Depression. So I was trying to pull this sort of land off and sort of bail out the farmers at the time. So they, as they were interning, you know, one of the gross injustices, as they were interning individuals across the United States, many times they were only interning men, but the families would come along. And so the federal government decided, in part because these camps were governed by international law, to design a program a camp specifically for families with kids. And so they put it in South Texas. So in Crystal City, there was this camp with 10-foot-high barbed wire fences, with armed guards at each corner, surveilling the scene. Many people talk about the fence sickness of being in there and what it means to lose your freedom. But the conditions were actually pretty good. There was indoor plumbing, which was not true outside. Houses, actually, that were bought after the camp was brought down are some of the best housing stock in the community. There was a pool. There was, I think, at least one theater troupe, maybe multiple ones. There were newspapers. Because it was actually governed by international law, and the United States felt like they should look good. So inside the camp, you had people who had suffered this great injustice, but had material conditions that were pretty good. And outside of the camp, you had people that were ostensibly free, but had terrible and segregated schools. And there are some communities that didn't have indoor plumbing until the 2000s in Crystal City. Housing stock that often was going to fall down, didn't have windows, and definitely none of those amenities. So I do find myself sort of constantly going back to that comparison, right, in this small space that I'd never known about, and thinking about the fact that Japanese Americans inside the camps did receive reparations, that injustice was acknowledged to some degree. But we never have acknowledged as a nation the injustices on the outside.
Thank you. I'd like to take this opportunity to broaden our conversation by asking my colleagues John Eason and Corianne Scally to join me on stage. Thanks. So by way of introduction, John Eason is a senior fellow and equity scholar in the Justice Policy Center and the Office of Race and Equity Research at the Urban Institute. He is also the Watson Family University Associate Professor of Sociology and International and Public Affairs at Brown University and author of Big House on the Prairie, Rise of the Rural Ghetto and Prison Proliferation. Corianne Scally is a senior fellow in the Metropolitan Housing and Community Policy Center at the Urban Institute, where she explores affordable housing and community development policy and practice from large cities to rural towns. Her research focuses on multiple social determinants of health, from the affordable housing supply to quality drinking water to access to health and human services, and the policy environments and the stakeholder capacities that affect community opportunity and well-being. Thank you for joining our conversation today. John, I want to start with you. And you know, one of the industries that Luke and colleagues don't really spend much time discussing is the prison industry. What do we know about the role of prisons in rural communities?
Before I go into my book on this specific mm-hmm. topic, I did want to acknowledge that I'm really happy about the work that Luke has done, especially elevating the concept of internal colonies. That was a concept that several prominent black scholars at the time developed and never really took traction. It never really got hold. So I'm happy that they've reached back to pull that concept forward and acknowledge those scholars. The other thing I want to say is where Luke left off, just to make this conversation contiguous. Mm-hmm. There's a difference between immigrant detention centers and prisons, but it's funny that you mentioned Crystal City because it's the site of an immigrant detention center. And it's not by chance that it's also it also held prisoners of war and that there was a public works project there, because that's what prisons are. We often don't think of them that way. In Big House on the Prairie, Rise of the Rural Ghetto and Prison Proliferation, I relocate my family from the south side of Chicago, my wife and two small children, in about 2006, 2007. And my question, I was coming into the field thinking about really how to close prisons, how to be a prison abolitionist. And even before I got firmly entrenched in the field, I had already run an analysis of every prison built during the 1990s to see what was the demography of places that predicted prison building. And contrary to what most people still believe, I have a blog on Urban Wire that recaptures some of this. But basically, black is the percent black and Latino in the town increases, the probability of building a prison also increases. So hence, this is where, when I entered the field with my family, we have a number of incidents I can go into at some other time that reveal what I'm calling a rural ghetto, which is some of the standard metrics that we've used in sociology and criminology to look at violence and other predictors of affiliated with crime and punishment. So these are residential segregation. I'm looking particularly at the town or below the town level. I'm not looking at the county level, and also poverty. So as poverty increases, residential segregation increases, the likelihood of building a prison also increases. This is also, I have some preliminary analyses around immigrant detention facilities as well. And the patterns hold as well. It's more Latinos in those towns than black folks in those towns. So part of why prisons get built, and I think this speaks to other industries, which I'm hoping for a robust discussion around this, is because of what was known as persistent poverty, right? But it's really this deep disadvantage, right? Which is much more than just poverty. These towns, the case study of Forest City, Arkansas, that I use for this ethnography, towns like Forest City, named after Nathan Bedford Forrest, founder of the KKK, and also an infamous, war criminal during the Civil War. You figure, okay, this just sounds super racist, right? The name of the town, if I was going to use a pseudonym, would be Racist Town. That's how racist all of this sounds, right? So it's just like, okay, the criminal legal system, we're building prisons. We know why we need to give people jobs, and these are all going to be white people who are racist who want to live out some fantasy of beating up black and brown people. But actually, the town leaders, which are not just white folks, because these are black folks who can object to a prison coming in, when I had the head of the NAACP tell me why he supported a prison coming, in one of my first interviews, I was rather shocked. It's because black and white leaders in towns like this are trying to rescue their reputation. This is about reputation management. So while, Luke, you talk about corruption, I also use some of that as well in thinking about corruption in this small town and how it relates to their spoiled identity and how the town is trying to manage its reputation by getting a prison. So some of you would say, how is a prison going to improve your reputation? The question you should be asking is the question I ask, which is, have you seen my backyard? How bad is your reputation? The question you should be asking if you think a prison will improve it, right? And so that's the entry point for this book. I'm doing more work here now at the Edin Institute, building off of the initial quantitative analyses that I have published and this book, this ethnographic case study. I'm following up with another mixed method project. The NSF funding that I received was for the Prison Proliferation Project, and we're expanding across decades, looking across multiple decades, and going all the way back to slavery, county proportion of slaves in 1860 to see if that has predictive power or for the entire population of prisons built in the U.S. today. Mm-hmm. We're also, in this book, I have two case studies, two rural communities where prisons are being closed, And I'm trying to figure out how to best reduce demand in these prisons. So if the prison, because they have other prisons, mm-hmm. but if we can change their menu options, give them some other preferences, we can curb demand in prison towns, right? And I think I'm using prison as one industry, but I think this this model that I've developed is bigger than just prisons. It fits any locally undesirable land use. Mm-hmm. So this is the same sort of thing. We would look to curb environmental justice or look to increase environmental justice mm-hmm. and the like. So I'm looking forward to hearing about some of the strategies at the end of the book that you guys start to lay out in terms of rebuilding rural America.
Mm-hmm. Luke, did people talk about prisons and incarceration much in the communities you visited, or?
We didn't hear as much about it, but in part it may be a part of the sampling frame. We certainly heard about, you know, the people we talked to had family members who were incarcerated and multiple occasions. But if you read John's book, I think you see all of the ways that this is like the next exploitative industry, right? And that the communities, you know, when I think about the leaders in the community that you're writing about, looking for like the economic savior and what's gonna bring jobs, what's gonna bring jobs that we can depend on over a long time. You know, think of all the different kinds of jobs that a prison brings. And sort of putting all your eggs into one basket, I think, you know, there's so much similarity. And as you were talking, I was actually remembering in Crystal City, just outside, there's an abandoned prison. It was a private prison, mm-hmm. and we had heard a couple different stories about how they got into trouble. And mm-hmm. and literally, it just looked like everybody had like left one day. So one of our research associates, Mara Cruz, and I, we actually walked around in it. It was one of the freakier moments of my life. But like the supply shed still had all the tools. There was a computer sitting there. All the gates were open, but it had been abandoned for years. So you could see. I mean, you could see the parallels between that and the Del Monte factory that came to town, right? Or the Russell mm-hmm. Stover factory that came to town and then one day just left and all of those jobs went away.
Hmm. So we focused a lot on challenges so far, and I'd like to shift to solutions. And Corianne, you've done considerable work on economic development. What can communities do to break the cycle of entrenched poverty, and to what extent are the solutions sort of out of the reach of communities and require state or federal involvement?
Yeah, thanks so much. You know, you both have done such tremendous work in this space, so thank you for helping to elevate these issues. I do think a key step towards solutions is more rural conscious policymaking and programming. So it's not that rural communities just need to work harder to address the inequities within and across their communities, but policymakers also need to work harder to make more rural conscious policies, that is, policies that really work well in rural places. And the fact that rural places are struggling today is a sign of both intentional harms, as you all have laid out, as well as unintentional equities that are built into our policies and programs. And Luke, in your book, you discuss, for example, disaster recovery and access to those resources, and you know that really shut out rural homeowners of color, for example. And so, really, in our policy space, folks are looking at the biggest places with the most people and with kind of an assumed status quo of how things work at the local level to implement programs and processes. You know, you can't blame folks for trying to find a one-size-fits-all solution, but I think both of your books and others, other work really illustrates that this doesn't work well for rural communities that are diverse in their histories, in their cultures, in their economies, and also in their physical and social infrastructures. And I really think that's something that we often overlook in our policymaking, is that rural community existence looks different physically as well as socially in terms of our policymaking. There are a lot of policies and programs that shut rural places out. We know, for example, that there's a dizzying array of programs at the federal level that specifically target rural communities. Thanks to an analysis by Brookings, there are at least 12 federal departments, let alone other agencies and sub-agencies that administer rural-focused funds. So knowing where to start for a community that's really just trying to advance can be really challenging. We also know that programs that require matches can be really challenging for rural communities to access, particularly those that are experiencing deep disadvantage that you both highlight, and the lack of monetary resources that they have. Also, programming and competitive programs particularly really require people with skills to write grants. And when you're looking at rural places, you're likely to find a very small number of local government staff, if any, that have those skills to compete in those programs. And then, of course, scoring criteria that are based on the number of people served goes without saying, or it should go without saying, that automatically rural communities with small populations are disadvantaged in those programs. I did also want to mention the flip side to focusing on, you know, where there is deep need, is to think about how to build on existing assets through solutions. So it's definitely important to understand historical context and challenges, but it's just as important to take note and scan existing assets in a community that can be mobilized for solutions. And there are many reasons for rural communities to be proud of their hometowns. There are strong civic institutions, many that you both mentioned in your research, the schools, the libraries, the 4-H programs that all work to build skills, to educate and to build relationships in community. There's also a lot of religious establishments and nonprofit organizations that are deep in the trenches of caring for these places. And so boosting the capacity of these organizations to do what they do really makes a lot of sense. These are the organizations that really help community members meet their basic needs. They often run emergency assistance programs that keep people fed, that keep people housed, that help people apply for social safety net programs that they're eligible for. These are the organizations that build quality, affordable homes to replace dilapidated housing in Colonias and other areas in Appalachia and elsewhere. And also community facilities like those schools and those libraries, child care centers, recreational centers, places where people can gather together. They support local entrepreneurs and they finance business growth and expansion to help provide economic stability to communities through good jobs. They also help update critical community infrastructure like community water systems and public wastewater facilities that we know are critical to ensuring we all have access to safe drinking water and that our waterways stay clean and safe. And they partner with healthcare providers to increase access to healthcare at the local level through really innovative solutions like mobile clinics or community health worker programs. Programs that take services to people who might be living in more remote areas, and also things through like school-based health clinics and substance abuse recovery centers as well. So investing in these types of organizations, I believe, are really key to really promoting community-driven solutions to some of these entrenched problems.
Thank you. And do you see in the communities you study, and John, the communities that you've been in, movements towards the type of community-initiated and sustained efforts that Corianne has suggested?
Well, I don't know if you want to. I think your book, the book ends with this, right? You end with this, so you have 4 or 5 main points. But I think that That's where I think not only the work Corianne's been doing, but I think that's where the field is headed, right? But I think the challenge, I don't want to focus on the challenges as much as to say a thing we really need to overcome in rural communities isn't just their lack of access, it's the lack of infrastructure. So even down to things like one of the communities I'm working in now, there's only one T1 line in town for the internet. One is at the community college. So you think about this, the digital divide is real in rural America, right? And then you have to have a lot of cultural sensitivity, right? So I'd like to change the menu options for rural communities to reduce their over-reliance on prisons. But if you go in and say, hey, would you guys like the Green New Deal? That's not gonna fly in rural America, right? Even that, you know, that's something Beltway insiders in this room, you guys get immediately. But why haven't we been able to advance infrastructure and other alternative energies as much as possible, especially in spaces that have like the space to take them on, right? It would be easier to, in spaces that are more open, to take these things on. So I think there's a lot of cultural sensitivity. We have a community engaged methods lab here at Urban. I'm actually using community engaged methods to work with the communities I'm working with in California. And you have to really get on the ground. It's not just to study them. I'm an ethnographer by training. I also do quantitative methods, so I do mixed methods. But it's not only assessing the problem on the ground, it's also being able to work with the communities to find solutions, right? So there has to be a way for us to prioritize these communities to get them the resources they need to even come up with plans. That's where we're at right now. I think you even mentioned that. Some of the plans were old and terrible, and they were really problematic, right?
Yeah. Yeah, I wholeheartedly agree with all of these sets of comments. I, you know, in each community we found, you know, we refer to them as hometown heroes, that despite, I think, so much of our safety net being stacked against rural communities in terms of being able to be competitive for grants, matching, capacity, all that stuff, people who really are ready to think differently a lot of the time. And we just saw the Cotton Bowl in Greenwood actually integrate for the first time in the last couple of years. So from these symbolic things to just really ready to sort of understanding that the way we've been doing business for so long isn't working. Mm-hmm. But it is going to take the federal government making changes, and there's not a single sort of one solution. It's got to be across all these things. I think broadband is such a good example. That is something that could be equalizing, and it is one of these issues that really can unite cities and rural communities, which on both parts of the country are struggling with digital inclusivity. So, but as John says, you know, we found a very, very low degree of trust and belief that the government could do anything to change. In fact, we had a question that said, what could a major foundation or the federal government do to make things better? And we rarely got any sort of answer. You know, that there's just such a belief that nothing that, you know, a lack of hope or a lack of belief that anything that they're going to do is going to impact. So it's really got to start, I think, with a lot of listening, with trying to match with where people are, trying to reorder the deck so that it's a little less stacked against communities, but a lot of showing value before there's going to be any trust with our experience.
Yeah. So I think, we like to think that policymakers work in good faith, and when things don't work out, it's an unintended consequence. But in your book, you sort of document that that's not always the case in the places where poverty is persisting. Can you talk a little bit more about how government corruption and out-and-out hostility towards people with low incomes are functioning in these places?
Yeah. So as I mentioned, I like to think of our book as maybe making some contributions on the nuts and bolts of structural racism. When you think about, like, this is how segregationist academies extracted resources from public schools. You know, we mentioned briefly disaster relief and this hugely racially unequal way that if your home is impacted by a flood or a tornado, who gets help and who doesn't? Predominantly white communities and higher income communities actually, you know, getting hit by a natural disaster is traumatic for everyone, but those communities actually end up wealthier on average afterwards, and low-income communities and communities of color end up poorer, and it's because of all of these things about how you get that sort of aid, including who has a clear title to their home. And so many homes across the South, especially owned by Black Americans, have been passed down through heirs' property. And this goes back, frankly, to Reconstruction and you know, the early days of 40 acres and a mule, and then that being drawn back, and then Black Americans owning property at, like, you know, buying property at hugely fast rates, and then every level of government sort of extracting that. So the history of social policy isn't about being in good faith. In fact, in so many ways, it's stacked against. It's sort of meant to, you know, keep this sort of order that we had, especially in these communities, in line. So in the communities, often I think, you know, our idea is when we have programs that go to communities, they should go to the community leaders. They know what's best for their communities. But if you take sort of everything I've just said, you actually have this sort of decades of history where it's been a contest between the haves and have-nots. And so at the best, like, community leaders often don't have a sense of what's going on with the lowest income members of their community. And at the worst, they're out for themselves. So every single community we were in had a fairly recent example of government corruption. So the one that you all might be aware of is the Mississippi welfare scandal, which famously involved quarterback Brett Favre getting like $1.1 million for speeches that he didn't give, and saying, of course, he never knew that there was an issue with where the money came from until his text messages came out and said, will anyone ever know where the money comes from? Which is usually a sign that you know, something's amiss.
You're not reading too much into that.
That's right. But that was an $80 million scandal that was started by a local nonprofit leader in Greenwood, Mississippi, Nancy New and her son. It involved Brett Favre, but involved former pro wrestlers. There was one former pro wrestler who actually was paid to give substance abuse speeches, like helping kids stay away from drugs. He himself got addicted to drugs, and they used temporary assistance for needy families' dollars to send him to rehab in California at like $64,000. It involved big ranches, horse ranches, famously a volleyball court. But in South Texas, in Crystal City, in like 2016, the FBI descends onto town and arrests every member of the city council and the city manager and the mayor for racketeering. You know, just one county over, you saw illegal gambling operations. And of course, up in Appalachia, it's just, again, like in all of these places, you can think of these issues as being things that just appeared out of thin air, or you can put them into the decades of history, right? This is like nothing new. And sometimes these communities, like, the power has shifted from the haves, the historical haves, to the have-nots. And sometimes they reproduce the exact same structures that the folks who were in power did before. But again, like, that's the model. That's how the town has worked. So we really think that when you're thinking about sending money down to communities, it's hard, but you have to think about who's getting the money. And how will it be used? Are there ways to get the money very much on the ground up? Like, the history of the war on poverty is very illustrative here, right? Where there was a conscious attempt to actually circumvent mayors and like community leaders, go directly to community organizations, Head Start centers, that sort of stuff, and a lot of pushback for that. So it's not easy, but We can't think of communities as monoliths at all. And also, for somebody who wants to run a small rural community, talk about capacity, there's almost no one in your corner, right? Sometimes there are things that help people get elected to these positions. But once you're running a small town, I can only imagine how lonely it feels, right? And how unprepared you are in continually complexifying world to do these jobs and to do them well. And so really thinking about how do we invest in the people who really want to do right by their communities. In my view, the other obvious solution is to do resources directly to individuals. So, I'll just mention something like the expanded child tax credit lifted millions of children out of poverty and didn't have sort of the impact that so many of our programs does of giving more resources to urban areas, right? It's really spread across the entire nation more uniformly, in part because it's a federalized program, and then it goes directly to individuals and families. So a combination of that type of approach, in my view, and approaches that really try to support communities from the ground up, that think about diversifying the economies of communities and building on the assets that are there. And of course, that's easier said than done.
All right, thank you. Corianne, any follow-on and advice of policies that?
I mean, I guess I would just go back to the capacity issue. You know, yes, there's definitely corruption, but I appreciate what you said about people who do want to step into leadership positions in rural communities. You know, really just being alone out there. You know, a lot of folks in smaller towns than I think most of the places were that you looked at. A lot of these folks are volunteering, right? They're volunteering to serve their community. Maybe they are born and raised there, most likely. And they look around and they see what resources to kind of learn the ropes of how how to be a professional community leader. There aren't really good guidebooks out there that I'm aware of for that. They just have limited reference to who they've seen serve in those roles before them. I do think that it's really vital we think about how do we build the local capacity to do the job well themselves, in an environment where there's just not really a lot of heroes to look up to, and really not a lot of guidance on how to serve their communities well.
Do you find that, John, as well?
I agree with that wholeheartedly. I think we actually I don't know if corruption is worse in rural communities than it is in urban communities. I think racism is worse, and some of my research bears that out. In terms of disparities for incarceration, racial disparities in incarceration being worse in rural communities than urban. But I think that the broader issue is the fact that these folks that, especially ones who have gone off and been educated and come back, whether or not they're formally trained to be leaders or not, the fact that they're willing to do it, I think is important. And there has to be a way to invest in them to improve their community. So I think the work that we're doing here at Urban and other NGOs, trying to provide technical assistance, as well as I'm happy to see more and more NGOs moving to community engaged methods. Because if you don't get on the ground and say, hey, what do you want, right? And start with the local leaders, and really trying to help them paint a vision for where they want to move their town and how to bring the people, their constituency along with them. I don't see how this isn't just a structural issue, it's a cultural issue. There has to be a cultural change, not just in rural communities, but in how we especially folks in the Beltway, look at rural communities. It's not just that they're all white, it's also that they're all Republican. And they're not. There's all sorts of interesting, fascinating, I should say, things about even prison towns specifically. But there's a lot of black folks who live in the South and a lot of Latinos that live in the South in rural communities who are very democratic. So these communities are very democratic, right? And towns that built prisons are actually more democratic than the average rural town, which is not something we normally think about. So it is about, I'm not advocating for Democrats or Republicans, I'm just saying how complicated this is and how we need to be on the ground to understand the nuances of each of these places and try and prioritize their needs and not go in with an agenda, right?
All right, thank you. I'd like to continue broadening the conversation by inviting the audience to share their questions in the Q&A box online. If you're online, you can just put the question right in the Q&A box and it'll come to me on this magical iPad. And for those of you in the room, if you scan the QR code, you'll have access to the Q&A box as well. So some audience questions. There's a sense that in rural communities where people have lived for generations, there are a lot of social connections. And are these types of social connections, social capital, resources for building out more social cohesion, or is that a myth?
The literature, Rob Sampson's book, talks about this, how social cohesion, the 2010 book, I don't know how I'm forgetting the title for this, but he talks about how social cohesion can be good for networks, they can improve things, but also social cohesion, and in many rural communities, it can keep people locked in place and block mobility because people are supposed to stay in their lane, in their place, and it just doesn't work. With like the white elite trying to keep black folks in their place. Mm-hmm. It also works along gender lines and lines of sexuality. So if you have any other gender or sexual orientation or expressions, you will be sort of shut down and pushed out to the fringes of the community. And that's also part of social cohesion. So it's a double-edged sword.
Yeah, I'm quite taken with the recent research showing that the connections across economic difference really can be mobility enhancing. And so strategies that bring people together, you know, that's, I think, one of those pieces of circumstantial evidence that we need to figure out ways to invest in social infrastructure. But I also, you know, we found both the impact of the opioid crisis in Appalachia, the impact of violence, especially in Appalachia and in LaFleur County and Greenwood, as being incredibly isolating forces. So just as John say, I think the social networks are often stratified by resources. And in Appalachia especially, we heard a lot about you get jobs based on your family name and your family. And so that's one way that the folks had some resources sometimes are perpetuated just in municipal jobs, teaching jobs, whatever they may be. So it can act negatively. But among low-income communities, just this sense that one of the ways I protect myself is by sort of retreating into my house and not associating either because of sort of the risks of drugs or the risks of violence. That's what we're sort of counteracting, what we're the tide we're fighting against.
So sticking on the theme of violence, one of the striking findings in the book was about the level of violence in certain rural communities, particularly Greenwood and Clay, but not so much in others like South Texas. Can you talk about some of, you know, why there's more sort of more violence, affliction of violence in some of these areas than others, or?
So I think that the Cotton Belt in particular has this incredible history of state-sponsored structurally racist violence that goes back for many generations. And so we really situate the violence that's experienced today within that. And the second piece is the social cohesion piece. So in South Texas, they have sort of gotten to a place where pretty much everyone in the communities is going to the same schools. So you have schools where the test scores is a sort of interesting juxtaposition, and it reminded me of Eve Ewing's book, Ghost in the Schoolyard, of schools that by some metrics are failing schools, right? So by like test scores are failing, but really have become sort of scaffoldings for the community, and you know, the band program in Crystal City brings everyone together. Just having the one high school, right, where everybody turns out, I think does build that sort of social cohesion. And you compare that to a place like Greenwood, where there's something like 7 or 8 schools in this small community. And just really in Manchester and in Appalachia, there's these rigid class lines where people really don't cross. So I think that sort of social cohesion of like the things that everybody comes together for seems to go along with it. I don't know the chicken and the egg sort of piece of that. So like if we brought that back, does violence go down, or like do you have to do sort of two things in tandem? But they're clearly linked to me.
So the populations you've talked about, Latinx, Black Americans, rural white folk in Appalachia, mixed. Where do indigenous populations fit in? How do you see this work applying to indigenous populations?
So originally our goal in this book was to also have a partnership with tribal land Native nations out west, because that's where you see like these, especially among that 100 most disadvantaged places, a lot of those Native nations are very high up on the index. They're not the clusters that you see, right? So if you go out west, actually you see more advantage. And when you look at all the indicators, actually you do wonder sometimes about our the directions we're in poverty measurement that defines some of the highest poverty in California. But on these other metrics, things are better out there, right? But in the West, you do see these pockets on tribal land. There, I think, is as we found, we were making slow progress in terms of finding partners, finding Native collaborators. One of the things we loved about our research team is we actually had people on our research team that came from the regions that we were looking into. We didn't have that on our research team yet, and we spent a lot of time finding partners, and I think there's a long history of why there's a lot of distrust in those communities, and I think more autonomy that can makes it difficult for scholars like us to partner, and that makes a lot of sense to us. I think we were moving that way, and then COVID hit, and tribal communities were particularly hard hit by COVID, so there was really sort of just a closing up of opportunities, and so we identify this as the part of the story that's not written. In some ways, they follow the same internal sort of colonies, I think, path that we see in other places that we track all the way back to, you know, scholars in the 1930s, and then going all the way back to Frederick Douglass, who I think was the first to really propose this sort of idea of a nation within a nation. In other ways, it's a different extraction of Native people being forced from lands and sort of constantly. And so I think it requires a lot of consideration, a lot of a lot of looking into the history, and I think we're doing a lot of that work across the nation right now, looking at schools, you know, looking at all of these incredibly important histories. We do actually talk about it some when we look at the places in the United States that have the are look the best on all these metrics. As I mentioned, again, we were kind of surprised to see, you know, when we looked at the top of the index, the places that have the lowest poverty and the longest life expectancy, being in Upper Minnesota and North Dakota, a little bit in Wisconsin, sort of all of that clustering. And, you know, one thing that people often mention is that that area is predominantly white, and that makes, you know, that's definitely a piece of the puzzle when you think about advantages that are sort of bestowed on white Americans. But there are other places that are just as white that don't look like that across the entire country, including Kentucky, but, you know, if you look at communities in Maine and elsewhere. The single biggest factor that we found that made this area different from other places was that they were disproportionately beneficiaries of the 1862 Homestead Act. Mm-hmm. The 1862 Homestead Act that only passed because the South had succeeded, and Southern lawmakers were adamantly opposed to sort of making landowners out of a broader swath of Americans, and led to widespread property ownership. And still in these communities today, you don't see huge plantations, you see small family farms. A lot of times, maybe the family isn't farming that land, maybe they're renting it to sort of big aggregate farmers. But the ownership is still like broadly based. And not to say they don't have their huge challenges themselves, but when you look at all these indicators, they look remarkably better than other places in the United States. But even the history of those places, so if we take sort of this notion that one aspect of thriving communities is broad-based sort of ownership of assets, those assets were particularly extracted from Native communities. And so, you know, even that, I think, in some ways, social policy success story that I think goes back more than a century is about extraction.
Thank you. Question for you, John. Now, so the institutions of prisons go beyond physical entities. They're often mental. In the rural communities you observed who were decreasing the number of prisons, were there any forms or models of restorative community justice or bolstering community infrastructure?
That research project is underway. So the lack of resources in rural communities really speaks to how much restorative justice is not like a real thing there. Even though those communities, I mean, one of the things I found in Forest City years ago, over a 25-year period, they had the same murder rate as Chicago, right? So it was at one point, I think, in the early 90s, they had a higher murder rate than Chicago. They still have a prison, though. Mm-hmm. But they had like different gang interventions, like Operation Ceasefire, things that you would see in big cities. But restorative justice is another primarily urban and urbanized. It's barely out into the suburbs, let alone rural communities, right? So even how they do restorative justice in schools and the like. And if you think about these Robert E. Lee academies that are still desegregate texts, because Forest City not only, of course, Forest City had a Robert E. Lee Academy, segregation tech. So they didn't really, those models really haven't permeated, given the social, this is back to your social cohesion, given the social cohesion in communities like that, it's not as deep or is wide in rural communities. Not saying it doesn't exist, but yeah, that's another one of these things that we can export. Although these things aren't one size fits all, as Corianne has pointed out, but I think there are certain things, because they're at the meso or micro level programs, that can flow out to rural communities. But that's a great question.
So a lot of the mobility literature talks about people in low mobility neighborhoods, and isn't it great when they move, and how much better it is when they move to a high mobility place? we've talked about what can we do about these low mobility places. Is the answer get people out of them?
I would say no.
I'm not surprised, but
I'm going to go with a hard no as well.
I'm going to say no. Mm-hmm. You know, I, and again, that's an extractive perception, right? To build on points that Luke has already made, that we have a history of moving people out, of forcing people to stay, moving people out, taking property, not acknowledging property rights. These are communities that people have called home for centuries, in a lot of cases here, you know, definitely for a few generations. And I think that, you know, to throw our hands up and say that, you know, that these places are hopeless, is not, you know, it's not equitable, particularly given the fact that we know the places that are struggling the most are ones that, you know, where the violence has been perpetuated on them, you know, from others, from the state, from the elite, from companies, et cetera, et cetera. So the reason that these places and the people who live there are struggling is not because there's something wrong with them, right? It's the infrastructure and the environment surrounding them and the policies and the actions of others that have often perpetuated injustices on these people and places. So I don't think the solution is to say they just need to move and go elsewhere. I think we really need to address the underlying systems, inequitable systems that are keeping these people in places in poverty, you know, continuing to expose them to harm and injustice, and failing to provide them with the economic opportunities that they deserve to have in those places where they live.
I think that's a great answer, Corianne. I just really, we act as if these high mobility places have all the answers, right? And you still see inequality in those places, right? You still end up walking. San Francisco is one of the richest places on the planet. Anybody been to the Tenderloin? Yeah. So think about that inequality, right? It's a high mobility place where companies were discovered in garages, apparently $1 million homes that had a garage in it. But we're not going to go down that route. But
nice garages.
Not really nice garages, but.
They didn't have automatic doors. You know,
yeah, they had to pull them up. It was such a hard time. The Moving to Opportunity study has shown that doesn't necessarily, like when you tear down public housing and move folks, this is about opportunity. It doesn't matter where you move folks. If you're giving them crappy schools, if you're giving them substandard schools, if you're giving them substandard health and human services, we're going to reap what we sow. It's pretty simple. We can either invest in people or we can continue down the path that we've been doing, right? We can invest in public works projects like prisons, where we try and take care of people after we have failed them, mm-hmm. right? Those are our options. So.
Thank you so much. We have many, many questions in the Q&A box that we haven't been able to get to. I think those are preserved on the event page. We've come to the end of our time for this conversation today. I want to start by thanking the audience for joining us and listening to the conversation. I want to thank Urban's event staff for the operational and logistical support to make an event like this happen. I'd like to thank my colleagues, Corianne Scaly and John Eason, and then especially to Luke Shaefer for writing such a thought-provoking and interesting book, which is available at your local independent bookstore or your favorite retail behemoth. and I'm looking forward to your future work as well. Thank you.